I was born in Atlanta, Georgia. And about the time I was 5 years old, my family moved to Florida. And I was raised in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, up until the time I was 15 years old.
Was it
14 years old?
Was it kind of a town or an urban kind of upbringing, or were you on the outskirts of town, or?
No, we lived right in town. Mm. Went to Central High School there.
What kind of place was that to grow up in that era?
Fort Lauderdale in those days was a great place, especially for children. You had all kinds of recreation facilities. You had the ocean. Ride your bicycle to the beach. You know, it was a terrific place.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I did.
What was it about school that you liked then?
Well, the curriculum, some of it I enjoyed very, very much. I had two older sisters that I learned a great deal from. And I liked the math, the geography, history. History was one of my favorites. That type of thing.
You know, when you walk into a classroom full of kids, there's this full spectrum of personalities. There's the quiet kid, the loud kid, the prankster, all of that. If we'd walked into your school classroom, which kid were you?
I was pretty much the quiet type. Tried to be.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Not drastically, but of course somewhat. But not to the degree that it did the people in the Midwest, we'll put it that way.
Tell me a little bit about your mother and father.
Okay, my mom is from Forsyth, Georgia. My dad is from near there, in a little community of Pelham, Georgia. And my dad is a veteran of World War I, field artillery. And my grandmother's home is in Forsyth, and we visited there in the summers, you know, school was out. Spent many, many days there.
Were they good parents?
Oh yeah, yeah, had a good relationship with my father and my mother. There's no problem there at all.
What kind of work did your dad do?
My dad was a linotype operator for a newspaper, typesetter, machinist, and that type of thing.
You know, at the age you are now, when you look back on your childhood in that era, did you like your childhood?
Pretty much. I would say, yeah, I had a very enjoyable time, I think. You know, I mean, we were comfortable, I'll put it that way. We got through the Depression without too much hardship. My dad was always employed, you know, and so it worked out pretty good. I had a lot of... As I say, Lauderdale was a great place to live. Kids, we had bicycles and go to the beach all the time.
Tell me what your situation was or your circumstances were when Pearl Harbor was bombed.
Excuse me. Okay, like all children, that era, my age, most of us had paper routes and a typical schoolboy type environment, you know. And I used to deliver the Miami Herald in Fort Lauderdale. And on December 7th, we deliver early in the morning, you know, morning routes and stuff. And in the afternoon, after the news came in from Hawaii, you know, late in the afternoon, well, the newspaper published what we used to call an extra edition. You remember that? I'm sure you had an extract. You read all about what's carrying on, you know. All right, he came by and got all the route boys because put us out selling newspapers right downtown. I was on the corner right in front of the post office in Fort Lauderdale, and he would deliver them. Boy, this is a big thing, you know. And golly, I don't know, he dropped off a couple hundred newspapers there, and they were gone within an hour, you know. And then he'd bring some more, and we'd stay there till quite late, 8 or 9 o'clock at night, selling papers, you know. And that was my opening day experience in war. I was 14 at that time. Yeah. December 7, yeah, I was
41.
Yeah, 41, I was 14 then.
Talk about then the circumstances under which you got into the Army Air Corps.
Okay. As everybody, as you're aware, the nation just shifted overnight to a wartime economy, you know. And so my mother and father moved from Fort Lauderdale to Washington, D.C. My mother took a job with the Veterans Administration at Walter Reed Hospital. My father took a job with the Washington Post and also worked at the government printing office. And I moved up there with them. And later on, can I back up a minute?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, okay. Just let me say that I have a cousin who was already a pilot in the Air Force prior to this. My dad in World War I, my uncles, we have a military history all the way back to the American Revolution, documented, you know. So military service was something that was in our family all these many, many years, all my lifetime of somebody in the service. So anyway, when we moved up to Washington, my mom was working out at Walter Reed, and then she was also working in one of the USO facilities, you know, where the servicemen, USO clubs they had. And I would go with her down there and spend a couple hours with her. And I got to know some of the service people and everything, and the whole nation was mobilizing, you know. My friends were dropping out of school and going here and there and different branches of service. So I just thought it was a thing to do. So I asked my parents about it, and they, my mom's a little reluctant at first, and my father agreed to it. And
how old are you at this point?
I was 15. So first thing I wanted to do was join the Navy, you know, big deal. So I went down to the Navy recruiting office, and the old chief there gave me some papers to fill out. This is a kicker right here. He gave me these papers, and he said, take these home and fill them out, have your parents sign them. Be back here tomorrow morning with your birth certificate. Okay, that's the end of that, you know. Recruiting over with. So I went down the street to the bus station in Washington. There's an Army recruiting station there. And this old chief, old master sergeant, he said, how old are you, Sonny? And I said, I just turned 18. Oh, okay. And what can I do for you? I want to join the Air Force. All right. Sat down and talked to him for a few minutes. He gave me these papers. He says, take these home, have your parents sign them, be back here at 6 o'clock in the morning. No word about a birth certificate. And that's what I did. And
did you put on your parents, signed the papers?
Yeah, they signed legally. But what I had to do was change my birth date, you know, had to tell the truth. I mean, fabricate that. And
Did you look a little older than you actually were?
Yeah, I really did. I could pass for being 17 anyway. I didn't have any problem with that.
I understand, you know, the military heritage in your family, but didn't anybody in the family question a 15-year-old going into the service at that point?
No, they didn't. And I've since found out, to answer your question or help with that, that there were approximately 7,000 underage servicemen in World War II. But nobody bothered me all the way through. I went from the enlistment, went down to Fort Lee, Virginia for induction, to Atlantic City for basic training, and took all the tests and everything, and qualified for three different deck schools. And I wanted to be a flight engineer, and the guy said, okay, that's fine, but you're going to have to stick around here about 6 weeks before we can find an opening for you, you know, and be on general duty and this and that. And he said, but if you want to go to radio school, we have opening, you know, we can get you in a class pretty soon, a lot quicker. So I did that. I went to Scottsville, Illinois for radio training. And while I was at Scott, they were taking applications, volunteers to go to gunnery school. So I passed all of that. And then we went to Las Vegas, Nevada for gunnery training. And following graduation from there, we went up to Ephrata, Washington, where the 483rd Bomb Group was just starting.
Let me ask you about the talk about the gunnery training. And had you had any experience with guns before you got in the service?
Just rifles and small shotguns, 20-gauge shotguns and 22 rifles. Everybody who grew up in South Florida had to have a 22 rifle, you know.
Talk about the gunnery training as far as what was the process they took you through?
A lot of classroom work initially, first couple of weeks. Classroom work started out, your actual gun training started out on a skeet field, shooting clay targets with a shotgun. You did that forever. You know, every day, no matter what stage, even later on in the Air Force, we were always shooting skeet. And then it went from classroom work to the firing range, still targets, you know, just getting acquainted with the gun, the machinery. And then we had simulators that were air operated that vibrated handle the back part of the machine gun, you know. So they would vibrate and simulate the actual recoil of the gun. And that was projected onto a three-dimensional screen, and that was very effective. They were a lot of fun to work.
Did you enjoy it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I was having the time of my life.
Well, I'm just thinking a 15-year-old shooting skeet. It actually sounds like a fun part of the process.
Yeah. Yeah, the whole thing in gunnery school was a lot of fun, you know. Excuse me.
Well, it gradually progressed to where you were actually using 50 caliber machine guns?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it just got, went, you know, every day was a little bit further along. And then they had seats set up in the back of a pickup trucks, and we'd ride in the back of that down a pathway, you know, and they'd shoot or launch targets out at different angles for us to shoot out from the back of the truck sitting there. That was part of it. That was got to be a regular thing. Almost every day we did some of that. Then you got into the machine guns and then into the turrets. And then from there, we went up to about 50 miles north of Las Vegas, a little subfield up there called Indian Springs. And we did our first aerial gunnery up there, shooting from the back of an AT-6. At the tow targets, you know, the canvas towed targets. We did that for about a week. I think we were up there a week. And went back to Las Vegas. And then from there on, we were shooting out of, they had Lockheed Hudson bombers, you know, the little twin-engine old style. They used those a lot for training planes, that type of thing.
Did you find you kind of took to the gunnery? I mean, you were, you know, pretty good at it, actually, didn't
you? Yeah, I thought so. Yeah. I mean, I graduated. I made the minimum, anyway. Yeah. So that was a lot of fun for us.
Where did it go from there, then?
From gunnery school, we went to Ephrata, Washington for the first stage of our, what we call, combat crew training. And there's three stages of that, each about 2 or 3 months long. And the first one was at Ephrata, then Rapid City, and then MacDill Field in Tampa. each stage gets a little bit more involved, you know. And when we finally got down to MacDill and the group had been formed, you know, all the organization and administration had been completed, then we took our final combat readiness exams and inspections and all that the Air Force gives you. And we were certified to go overseas, and we did shortly after that.
Which what was the number of the group that you were in?
I was in the 483rd.
And this in 15th Air Force?
U.S. 15th Air Force.
Yes. And talk about the phase training, when the crew came together. You had all these personalities from different parts of the country.
Right.
How did everybody kind of coalesce, all those different personalities?
Well, by this time we'd all been in the service at least a year, you know, pretty close to a year. And so it was easy to get acquainted with them, and we'd all had similar training. All the gunners had been to, well, same type of school. There were six gunnery schools, so it was easy to mix together. And when all this time we were still taking our flying responsibilities as well as ground school and aircraft recognition, you never got away from that.
Who was your pilot?
Our pilot was, well, there was more than one. We were moved around quite a bit in the initial stages of it. I think they did that to try to get the right mix of personnel together that seemed to go well. The gentleman I flew all my combat missions with was from Atlanta, Georgia. His name was Isham Teasley. Great pilot.
And I want to make sure we heard it. Say the name again, please.
Isham Teasley, T-E-A-S-L-E-Y. A great, great pilot. Young guy, probably 23 years old at the time. And
do you remember what your impression was of the B-17 at that time?
Yeah, I do. Because, well, let me back up a little bit. When we were in gunnery school in Las Vegas, we did not fly in B-17s at all. We had some there, but just two or three. We used a different type of aircraft. We did not know until we got to Ephrata what type of aircraft we'd be assigned to. We were trained in gunnery school where we could fit into any of the bombers that the Air Force had at that time. So when we got to Ephrata, well, we were pretty pleased that we had been selected to go to a B-17 group. Yeah, it's pretty impressive. Yeah. Glad it worked out that way rather than some of the other models, you know.
Which position on the aircraft did you end up?
Yeah. My permanent assignment was a left waist gunner. And then we were qualified to fly in any of the gun positions, and we would fly relief spots with some of the other gunners and some of the other crews. You know, there's always somebody sick or missing a mission, or they got to have makeup over here. We'll make up a crew. Well, you'd end up. I flew in all the gun positions before I was finished.
Did you fly over to Europe?
Yes, we did. We went from MacDill Field in the same airplane we were training in. Flew up to Hunter Field in Savannah, and there we were issued brand new B-17 Gs, just like that one. And we flew those airplanes through the southern route, through Waller Field, Trinidad, Brazil, Northwest Africa, Tunis, Marrakech, and on over to Italy.
You know, that's such a long journey. What comes to mind when you think about that long journey that back then?
It was broken up into 49 hours, I believe, 49 or 50 flying hours. And I think there was about 9 stops along the way for that. And it took us about 2 weeks to get it done, you know.
How'd you occupy your time on the air, on the airplane on all those hours?
Just sitting there. The radio operators, you know, we had two radio operators on there, and we'd spell off the work on operating, and we'd just play with radios and, you know, listen to music and this type of thing.
These are pretty exotic locations you're going to, you know, Trinidad and Brazil and Morocco. And did you get a chance to kind of look around in any of these locations?
Not really. I think we went to town in Tunis because we were out there about a week, and I think we had an opportunity to go to town there. That was the only place. The rest of the time we were on base.
Do you remember what you thought about that? I mean, I'm just picturing this kid from Fort Lauderdale, and now you're in Tunis. What did you think about the place?
It was quite a shock to see that, cultural differences, you know, and the city hadn't been modernized there in hundreds of years, you know. It was pretty much the way it was. And it was a little culture shock there. But that was about the only time we had the opportunity to go to town.
So you, where did you eventually arrive then?
We eventually flew into Foggia, Italy. And there were, Foggia was surrounded by it was a complex of airfields surrounding there, I think five or six different ones. And we stayed there about 3 weeks, flying with the two other groups that were already there, and they were constructing a airfield for us about 50 miles north of there. So when that was completed, we moved up to a little place called San Severo and flew out of there.
Do you remember the approximate month and year you arrived there?
Yeah, we arrived in Foggia about 1st of April, 1944. And maybe when 2nd, and then we flew our first combat mission on the 6th day of April.
When you flew over to Europe through the southern route, did you fly alone or as a group?
No, we flew as a group. All of us, the 72 airplanes went together. Not in formation, but, you know.
Could you see each other? Was it like a long stream of airplanes?
Yeah, we were always inside one another. Yeah, we took the whole air echelon with us. And the ground crews went on ships, troop ships over.
So this was basically a new base that was being established there?
Mm-hmm. New base being built just for us. And it was steel mat runways and tents. We lived in tents and stuff. We didn't have all these five-star accommodations.
The Quonset huts.
Yeah, we didn't have all that.
How many missions did you fly?
50.
50?
50. Everybody in the 15th Air Force flew 50 missions. That was a quota for us.
You're not going to... do you remember your first mission?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hey, can you tell us the story? Because that's sort of, you know, that's your first mission. What do you remember about that?
It was pretty uneventful, you might say. We went just across the Adriatic Sea to place over in Yugoslavia, on the coast there, a place called Broad Yugoslavia. I think it was a railroad yard, a marshaling yard, and very little flak activity, some, but we call it moderate flak activity. And there was no damage or no injuries or anything like that.
Do you remember what, you know, you got back, you'd been a first combat mission, what impression did it leave on you?
Well, not a whole lot. It was pretty routine, you know. Up, you know, the first one was didn't amount to much. We knew it was going to get worse, but so.
Are there? You're obviously not going to remember all the missions.
But, no,
but there's probably missions that stand out for one reason or another. Can you tell us about some of the missions that you flew that do stand out for you?
Well. Yeah, the probably the worst one that our group was on was towards the last of it. Well, it was July the 18th. By then, we had flown 45 missions, you know. And on that particular one, we hit an Luftwaffe airfield up in Minningen, Germany, and we lost 66% of our aircraft. So that was the worst one we had.
Well, you know, tell me the story of that mission. What happened? That's an awful lot of airplanes. What did you see?
We decided we didn't have hardly any flak activity. It was all fighters. And our group destroyed 52 different enemy fighters that day. And it was kind of a lot of things happened during the war. It was a fiasco, weather-related, you know. There was supposed to be four groups go up there, and some of them were recalled because of the weather, and our group leader elected to go, so we went alone, you know. And so it wasn't a good day for us.
Did you fire the guns that day?
Oh, yeah. Everybody fired the guns that day, yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, for people who, you know, for most of us, we only know about this by watching movies and things of that sort. What does it really look like with fighters? When a fighter's coming in, what does it look like?
Well, it's you're busy. But it's over with so quick. You know, each individual fighter pass only lasts a few seconds. And you have very, very little opportunity to identify the aircraft, you know, and determine first off if he's within range and is he a satisfactory target for you. And then you've only got just a few seconds to make up your mind how to do it and things like that, and it was a busy day. It really was.
How do you know if you've even hit anything?
Well, you do. I mean, you can see pieces coming off of it. You can sometimes they'll explode. Sometimes they'll engine will go on fire. Or they'll start trailing smoke or this type of thing. And then sometimes your friends will, you know. You're in formation with, and maybe they'll be shooting at a plane with you, you know. Maybe lots of times there'd be two or three guys shooting at the same airplane, you know, this type of thing. So it was easy, not easy, but I mean, you could get sorted out. Yeah. You know, how we did that.
And was there sort of a feeling of shock after that mission? What was the sense or the feeling after that mission?
Well, we were all glad to be home, but of course, it felt the loss of our comrades, you know, of course. But it was just the only thing you could say was, grace of God, go away, you know, because, and then we had to fly the next day, you know, just the way it was. You know.
And that's a good point, though, the way it was. That is, you know, what was it in you that allowed you to just keep going and keep going, given, especially after a devastating mission like that? How do you keep going?
Well, that's pretty hard to answer. I don't know. It's just something you agreed to do, and this is what I signed on to do, and beats walking, you know. We were glad we were there. So I never knew a man to resign or quit or, you know, back out of it at all. Nobody.
Didn't want to let the other guy down?
No, you had your loyalty to your crew. You wouldn't dare even think about reneging on it, you know.
And your pilot, was he a good pilot?
He was an excellent pilot.
Were there particular things you would, what was he good at? Let's put it that way.
He's a very efficient pilot. He's a very good formation flying pilot, you know. And more so than anything, he was a great commander. He was a great, great guy to work with, you know. And so, I don't know, we had a good crew, a good mix. Everybody got along well.
That's certainly a memorable mission you've just described. Was there other missions for one reason or other that stand out in your mind?
Well, some of them were milk runs and some were worse. Vienna was an extremely bad place to go. We went to Vienna 3 times, I think. I think the group went up there like 22 times, but I only went on 3 of them. We went to Palesti 8 times, and I went on 5 of those.
And let me back up. Why was Vienna such a bad place to go?
It's oil refineries up there, and synthetic oil plants and oil plants and rubber plants and things of that, you know, strategic plants for the Germans and heavy flak batteries, that type of thing.
For people who don't know what flak's like, can you tell us what that's like to fly into something like that?
Well, you know what it is, of course. It's anti-aircraft shells that are armed to go off. They're either timed or it's on a pressure switch, one or the other. I don't know exactly how they set them. But the shells, once they got your altitude and your range, well, they would arm these shells to go off pretty much at your altitude, you know, or maybe slightly below you or something. And these things are exploding all around you, you know, and you have no control over it. You've got to stay right on your bomb run, you know. You can't take any evasive action and all that business, you know. And then, so.
How do you know if the aircraft, what does it sound like when, or look like when flak hits your aircraft?
Well, what it really sounds like is if you take a handful of small rock gravel and something, and throw it against, or small rocks, throw it against the side of the airplane, that's what it sounds like when shrapnel's hitting your airplane. And of course, a lot of noise, a shell, you can hear the shells explode if they're close enough.
And you also mentioned missions to Ploiești in Romania.
Mm-hmm. And yes, sir.
Why was that also oil facilities?
Yeah, that was the biggest. Ploiești alone produced something like 40% of German oil. It was a very vital target for them.
What do you remember about, you went there quite a bit. What do you remember about those missions?
This is pretty much the same. Heavy, heavy flak. It was one of the most heavily defended targets that we hit was in Ploiești. Not too many fighters, you know. And you either had one or the other, you know. If you have fighters, and you start down a bomb run, and the flak starts, well, the fighters are going to leave, you know. And they'll be waiting for you on the other end. And so you never had the two at the same time. You know, might have two on the same mission, but not at the same time. And I don't know how that was.
Was there anybody on your crew that was ever injured?
You know, on our aircraft, we were, other than some minor scratches, you know, that are not worthy even talking about, we didn't have any injuries. Our pilot was killed on the last mission. We weren't flying with him, but that was a takeoff accident and not combat related. But all of our crew survived pretty much unscathed, you know. I mean, some of the guys we got nicked up on other crews and stuff like that, and Purple Hearts here and there, but as a crew, as a unit, we were lucky, you know.
Did you ever give thought at the time to that sort of luck aspect? You know, one guy goes on with another crew for one mission, gets shot down, wrong place, wrong time, all that. You know, guys who carry the lucky rabbit foot, you know. what was your sense, if you had any thoughts about this, of sort of the luck, the fate, the, you know, of all this?
Yeah, there's a lot to that. I guess we thought about that a lot. I know we had to farm out our co-pilot one day, one mission. We had to loan him out to another aircraft, and he got shot down over Pulaski, incidentally. And we were watching him. So that was kind of a bad
Did he make it? I mean,
He became a POW, yeah, Carl Spencer. And, Cecil Spencer. So it was, those things happened, you know. And but as a cohesive unit, our crew was very, very fortunate. And
Were there any missions you lost an engine?
Oh, more, yeah, lots of, yeah. That was a pretty common event.
When that would happen, would you have to drop out of the group? Coming back, were you able to stay? Were there ever occasion you lost an engine and you were out there on your own, that kind of thing?
Not really. No, you could keep up on three, and you keep up on two engines if you were empty, you know. So we were all right in that respect. Of course, you didn't return in as tight a formation as you went as you flew over, you know, and flew down the bomb run, and you kind of get a little bit scattered on the way home. But you could keep up with the rest of them. You were empty, you know, that was all right.
Did you ever have any times losing an engine and you had a propeller that was windmilling and you weren't able to feather it?
No, on our plane we never had a windmilling prop or a runaway prop, no. Mm-mm. I know what they are, but No, we didn't have that.
It sounds like on some of your missions, you had to make it over the Alps.
Quite frequently, yeah.
What was it like flying over those high mountains?
Switzerland was always right there off our left. We were right up the internet, you know, right up the borderline. And it's quite high, cold, snow on them all the time, you know. Beautiful.
On your missions, as you kind of reflect back on them, there may not be an answer to this question, but as you reflect back on those 50 missions, do you remember anything unusual that happened, odd, unique, something that sticks in your mind?
They were quite similar, you know. Some missions were just complete milk runs. You know, where you didn't have any flak opposition, or you didn't have fighter interceptions or anything. And then some days we wouldn't fire guns at all. And then other times we were quite busy with them, you know. So nothing, we didn't have any spectacular things go wrong, you know.
Were you able to get time off between missions where you would go into a town or anything like that?
Well, we were probably 35 miles from the closest town, something like that. And what I'm going to tell you is this is a schedule, but there's a lot of variables in the schedule, you know. But we were programmed, we had enough air crews and enough airplanes. We were programmed to fly 2 days and off one and fly 2 days and off one. Now you got to take into that the weather, you know, and aircraft damage, and if you get sickness or digestive problems, you know, this and that, all that enters into it. But if things were going well, you'd have a day off every second day, you know. So we could, and then we got a couple of times, we got 3-day passes. We went to Naples, we went to Rome. We go into Foggia, stay a couple of days and come back. Well, yeah, we did get around the countryside a little bit.
Did you get a chance to deal with the Italian people at all?
Mm-hmm.
What was that like? I mean, these are former enemies, you know.
Well, yeah, we didn't see too many of their former service people, but Italian people were very, very cordial, very generous to us. I liked them very well. And they seemed to be like what we were doing for them. I was appreciative of it. So,
when you you flew your, well, actually, let me ask you something. You had to fly 50 missions to complete your tour to go home. That is in the 15th Air Force, whereas the 8th, which covered the northern part of Europe, started at 25 missions, moved to 30, and then it ended up at 35. Was there any kind of feeling, do you have some sense of why the difference between the 8th and the 15th on the number of missions they had to fly?
No, I really never did know why it was that way. I understand, you know, we knew why the mission count was always being increased, and that was because of the attrition and the schools and the training program couldn't keep up with the demand, you know, because you're trying to expand your Air Force and you're losing some through combat losses, and then you got to send them home after 25 missions. Well, you don't have 90 days service out of these guys, you know, and it took you a year and a half to train them. So put a terrible strain on the schools to do, on a training command to do that. So they just kept up in the ante.
Was there any kind of, I don't know, resentment on, you know, in the 15th, because you actually had to fly 50 missions, whereas these guys in the north didn't need to fly that many before they could go home?
No, we never felt that way about it. They just, that was the way it was. we never thought about it, you know, because I understand the guys in the 20th Air Force, they didn't have a mission count. They just stayed over there forever, you know. I mean, as long as they were needed.
Did you fly any missions or to Africa?
No. That was over with, see, by the time we got there. And the African campaign was over. We flew directly to Italy. I guess the highlight of the whole thing would have been the shuttle mission to Russia. We flew up, hit a refinery in Romania, landed in Russia. We were there a week. During that week, we flew another mission out of Russia and back again. And then we flew a mission on the way home. So actually, we flew 3 missions in that week.
Did you get a chance to interact with any of the Russian people?
Oh, yeah. That was a lot of fun. We got to know them and meet with them. And we stayed at one of their camps, you know. We had our meals there with them and everything. And they were quite nice. They were a lot of good people there. We couldn't communicate very well, but that was a good deal.
Do you remember? I don't know. Do you remember anything specific as far as anybody you encountered there, or an experience, or something that sticks in your mind?
Not so much. I do remember the Air Force had set up for us a place to have. Well, they had some showers rigged up for us down on it by a stream with a little, they'd made a little wide place there for it. Worse than we could go down there and take a bath, you know. And I remember this old gentleman came by one time with his young granddaughter. She must have been 4 or 5 years old, something of that nature. And we'd had our showers and we were kind of swimming around there in the shallow water. And anyway, he took this little girl down into the water to give her a bath, you know. And they had never had soap. And we had all the soap we could carry, you know, just the opposite. And so we gave him about 6 bars of soap. and they were so appreciative of that, that something that is so common to us, that it's such a big thing for them.
Do you remember the last mission that you flew?
Pulaski.
Oh.
Yeah, I made my line August 8th, 1944.
Any sort of, I don't know, superstition about that mission and going on, knowing it was your last mission and it was to Pulaski? What were you thinking at that time?
Well, yeah, you were thinking about it, all right. But no, we didn't really. We knew we were all finishing, and incidentally, we were all finishing the same day, except for our pilot, who flew another few days. He had stepped on a nail and got a foot infection. He had to sit out a few missions, and then that's why the incident happened. But we knew the whole crew was finishing that day. And so we were pretty confident, you know, looking forward to the celebration that night.
And was there the celebration?
Yeah, there was quite a celebration. We had some world-class hangovers.
Well, you finished your missions then. Where did it go from there?
We went to Naples and returned home on a troop ship. Troop ship was the USS Marine Robin, who was carrying 5,000 German prisoners and 1,500 GIs. I remember that trip real well, and it took 17 days. Went into New York Harbor.
What was it like on the? That's a long time over a lot of water. What was it like on that ship?
Very boring. Extremely boring.
You
nothing
have,
to do.
Did you have to do guard duty or anything like
no,
that?
No. They had. There was a branch of the service you probably call the armed guard, and we didn't have anything to do. Just
any
play cards. That's all.
Any interaction with the Germans on board?
No, we were not allowed to, you know, associate with them in any way. They were allowed to come up on deck twice a day, get fresh air and stuff like that. They'd come up twice a day, and we had to go down. We weren't allowed to be up there. But that was an interesting trip. And following that, I think everybody was given a 30-day leave. I reported to Miami Beach, and from there, I was assigned to the Air Transport Command, 4th Fairing Group in Memphis, Tennessee. And I flew with them for a while.
You know, one question in that time period, what was it like to get back to the U.S. after flying 50 missions and all that combat?
You know, it was okay. Everybody was kind of laid back and relaxed. After we got out of training, you know, going back to MacDill and everything, it was kind of army-like in those days. But after we got back home, they treated us quite well. I have to say that the army kind of did us, you know,
what was
justice. I'll say.
What was the homecoming like? You know, going home. I'm picturing this Norman Rockwell, you know, moment. Mom in the kitchen. You know, what was it? What happened?
Well, no, it was okay. Yeah, I first went up to Washington to see my parents, and then I went, you know, down to Florida to report for duty in Miami. Went up to Memphis, started flying up there, the Air Transport Command. That was all domestic stuff, transports and freight, and, you know, cargo, this and that, just wherever they needed you. I flew with them for a while, and I decided I wanted to fly. I want to volunteer for another air combat tour.
Why did you do that?
Well, I was getting kind of bored. So I did this, got the letters, and, you know, had to have the first sergeant draft the letters for me and everything. And I was transferred to Biloxi, Mississippi to Keesler Air Force Base. And I was in training, kind of retraining, to go back to the tour duty in the Pacific. And then the war was over. So I was on flight duty right up to the very end.
When were you discharged then?
August 1945, something like that, right after the war.
Were you tempted to stay in?
Not at that point in time, but I was out of the service a year, and I re-enlisted and stayed a year and was discharged. I had an option to get out of that, stayed a year, yeah.
What was your occupation then after the service?
I became an electrical engineer, and I worked here in the United States. First, I worked as an electrical power lineman for about 20-some years, and then I went to took a job in Saudi Arabia, and I worked 28 years in Saudi. And that's when I got into engineering work. And I just retired last year in August.
Did I forget to ask anything?
No, just while we're here, I'll just take a minute. When the Korean War came by, I went down to re-enlist. I was going to join the service again, go back in the Air Force. And I went down and talked to him, and I could not pass the eye exam for flight duty, so I declined. I just, no. They wanted me to come in, and, you know, they were looking for anybody they could get to come back, and I said, no, if I can't fly, I'm not interested. So that was pretty much the end of my Air Force career in those days. Yeah. I stayed in that 1 year I went back and re-enlisted. I was at Boca Raton Air Force Base in Florida, and I was assigned to an air sea rescue squadron, and that lasted about 6 months, I guess. And then they were retiring all the air, you know, they were demobbing, they were getting rid of everything. So they demobbed that unit, and I was assigned to the base operations office for flight operations, and I worked in there for about 6 months as a flight dispatcher. And then they were going to close the base, and at that point in time they were still trying to get rid of people by then, and they said anybody that has more than 3 years, less than 3 years to go on their service can apply for a discharge. So I did that. I've had enough of this. The Air Force was changing dramatically from a wartime place, you know, mode to a peacetime mode, and it wasn't as much fun as it was before.
You know, when you got out in 45 the first time, how old were you at that point?
I'd have been 17, just before my 18th birthday.
So your whole World War II experience was you were under 18.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then I had an interesting experience with that. When I turned 18, I went down to the draft board to register. You know, that was the law. We had still the draft. Well, you don't have any friends on the draft board, you know. So since I had entered the service, so to speak, illegally, they didn't want to recognize my service, you know, because I was entitled to be to a veteran's deferment, you know, rating 5 or something like that. And they wanted me to go right back to service. They weren't going to give me credit for having once been in the service. So we sparred around with that for a few days, and finally I called my mother, and she was still in Washington, and as it so happens, Congressman Dwight Rogers was from Fort Lauderdale, and I had been a schoolmate of his son, Doyle Rogers. And so my mom went to see him, and he got it straightened out for me. And they didn't bother me anymore.
You know, when you look back on that time all those years ago, were you proud of your time in service?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I believe so. I certainly wasn't ashamed of it, but look back on it, and I think we like to think we contributed something, you know. And
were you proud of your crew?
Oh, gosh, yeah. Yeah, we had a great bunch of people. And the mom group was a great outfit to belong to. We had good leadership, very fine people.